Okay guys, lesson 4A, that's technology trends through the end of 2014. These are a set of, well, it says trends, how things vary with time, usually and chosen to be the things of relevance, the big data, clouds, etc. And we need to show how they change. And rub in all these trends, such as AI first, big data, growing use of clouds, disappearance of things like shops, the Internet of Things, etc., etc. That's what these trends document. So this section on industry trends has three lessons. There's so many trends. The first lesson is the earlier years through the end of 2014. Thank you so much. Here is the famous Moore's law curve, the cost of computing as a function of time, which is decreasing exponentially. And it shows the over this period from 1990 to 2012, or maybe it's actually 2014 is the last thing here. It shows a factor of, let's think what it is, it's a factor of 10,000 decrease. And as I pointed out, there's been a switch in the trend. It used to be that this Moore's law was gave you more powerful computers. Now it tends to give you smaller computers because you can't increase the clock speed anymore. But, what's slightly surprising, actually, you're still getting this dramatic computing cost decrease without a change in slope, because one of the change in slope used to come partly from the size change and partly from the clock speed, and you've lost one of three axes, because you had the x and y axis of length and the time dimension, three things all decreasing at the same rate, changing at the same rate, and that gave you the original Moore's law. Here we have the current version of Moore's law from, and this comes from the Mika famous internet trends presentation. Notice this is the cost for a million transistors. And it's worth noting, you can build a decent computer for actually less than a million transistors. So this shows you computers don't cost very much. Okay, here's a special slide from 2018 Internet Trends, which partly includes the information in the previous slide. This is the calculations per second from the major computer for $1,000 worth of computers. And over here is the same thing for storage. Here we have the price to store, price per gigabytes dropping drastically. And here we have the hard drive capacity. Here we have 10 terabytes up here. So these are all the trends that we see in day-to-day life because they affect our PCs and even our smartphones. And as we know, they are tailing off because of the so-called end of Moore's law and maybe the beginning of quantum computing. I don't think I'll have a quantum smartphone. Maybe I'm wrong, but that would be fun. All right, that's great. Thank you. Next time, we will return to the past in the slide after this. Here is the same thing for storage. And storage is actually decreased more than computing. Remember, computing went from this cost here roughly down to 0.05. So storage is actually is getting cheaper slightly faster than computing, although there is actually a slight change in slope around here. And the slope is decreased, and so probably slopes are similar. But 38% annually is pretty impressive. I remember,
thinking of buying large storage systems around there, that would in some sense been a mistake. Investing in storage is not an easy thing to do given this drastic change in cost. Anything you buy is sort of out of date. And now we come to bandwidth. This is only decreasing 27% every year, the cost of bandwidth. This actually looks a bigger effect because this number, this difference here is less than a factor of 100. However, the time period is different. The previous time periods went from early 1990s up to 2012. But the best number to use is the 27% versus the 38% for storage. So bandwidth is drastically improving, and in fact, the bandwidth is possibly the most important part of the internet, because it's the bandwidth has enabled the internet. You can say the computing and the storage decline has enabled clouds to actually act as the repository of the internet, and the computing has enabled smartphones and thin clients to enable broad universal access to everything. So this again comes from the KPCB Internet Trends presentation. Here is some again from the Mika 2013 talk. We have some comments on sort of the world. Here is sort of an interesting comparison of advertising, which is blue, versus actually how people spend their time. And the claim is there's sort of some interesting features here. For TV, which has 43% of the advertising budget, people spend 42% of their time. So that's pretty well matched. Internet isn't too bad, 26% of their time, 22%. Advertising, and the interesting numbers are here for print. Print is 6% time, 23% of the advertising, and there is the major discrepancy is mobile, 12% of time, 3% of advertising. So that's the origin of the huge emphasis on mobile advertising and the possibilities there. And that's helping companies, especially like Facebook, which are particularly strong on mobile platforms because their interface is very well suited, is as well suited for mobile as it is for desktops. Radio is also interesting that actually time spent on radio is again less than the advertising, which is slightly surprising for a rather old technology, showing that radio is still possibly healthy. Here we have some comparison of internet sites by visitors, and we can see they're dominated by these standard companies, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, Yahoo, Wikipedia, Amazon, Apple, and I must admit I don't know the others. And here we have some important Chinese sites, Tencent and Baidu. I actually don't know what Glam Media is. And the interesting feature is the blue are international users, so that's dominance of Chinese sites. But even if you look at the US sites, they're largely international users. So this is this rather remarkable statistic. 81% of the users are outside the USA, but 80% of the sites are inside the USA, which shows that as we USA remakes its industry, it's exporting internet sites in a rather dramatic fashion. Here we have another version of this plot in a later slide, but here is an illustration of how there's been, even from 2005, a drastic change in the smartphone operating environment. We used to have here in 2005, we had Symbian, which is now essentially disappeared. Linux disappeared, although Android and iOS are actually Linux variants, so it's not really possibly fair. And BlackBerry, of course, is, well, actually, BlackBerry's gone up a little, potentially a little, but it's still very small. There must have been a time in the middle where BlackBerry actually was quite big. And the dominant now, of course, is Apple here, iOS, and the dominance of the commodity operating system, which is Android. So drastic change. And of course, iOS and Android, in some sense, are made in USA, which is the origin of this comment in the title here. Here we have looking at the social media with Facebook and Twitter and YouTube as dominant social media. They're actually, if you did it today, I think you'll find Google Plus would have gone down, and some of these other ones like Tumblr would have gone up. There's quite a lot of changes in this field. But anyway, this is from 2013, or a year and a half ago. And so this points out there are some important changes with time, even for over a one-year period. And for, actually, though, Facebook is very healthy. It's actually technically declined a little. That's because it owned the world for a while, but now others are catching up. YouTube has, there are various things like which YouTube is a dominant force in, and you could even say this course is one of the things. This course is hosted on YouTube. So YouTube has got a strong reputation for certain types of usage, which is pretty different from the Facebook usage. So YouTube has got a lot of professional and other types of uses on it. Here's a nifty curve from looking at desktop versus mobile. This is a trend which people love to emphasize, that we're moving from a desktop dominated world to a mobile dominated world. And of course, although there are a lot of people who use both, that's why you can have 75% in China from mobile and 71% for desktop. But this is, in some sense, a consequence, again, of this lightweight client technology shift coming from the fact you can build very powerful computers that are very small, which means that you can put into a smartphone and a computer that's perfectly powerful, as big as a supercomputer was not so many years ago, and able to do anything you could possibly want. And You already have multi-core chips inside smartphones, and those multi-cores will continue to increase because there's nothing else you can do with that silicon. Here we have Alibaba. Actually, this will be even more dramatic if you looked at it recently, because Alibaba just had an IPO on the U.S. stock market where it got some dramatic valuation. And it's also remarkable, which is still true, and that's what's highlighted in this IPO, that Alibaba is bigger than the combined eBay and Amazon. Although Amazon is pretty healthy, eBay is somewhat struggling in terms of its increase. It's leveled. It's somewhat. It's increasing much less than the other companies. I have no idea why that is, because the eBay's model appears to be a pretty reasonable model. Here's a very cosmic graph of a gross national domestic product. And it points out that here we have Europe. That's this green, which used to be dominant and is declining. We have China, which is, remember what the scale is. Here we have 1820. That's quite a long time ago. Here we have where we are today. And we have actually India has declined, but then coming up. Latin America, actually went up and then declined a bit. I have no idea why. But possibly this decline is just the growth in China, just changing the denominator when you calculate percentages. It probably is still increasing. And here we have USA again going down, probably for the same reason that it's dividing by China, which is going up. But the most dramatic is at one time, for instance, Europe was ahead of the USA, and that sort of crossed in the time of the Second World War. And now, then after the Second World War, it continued to increase above USA, but now it is below the USA. And I expect that trend to continue because at the moment, innovation is much more dramatic in terms of China, Asia, and the USA. Those are the dominant technology companies, and Europe appears to be struggling to compete in this world. Although it's still a healthy, important, big economy. Here is another graph pointing out the growing importance of mobile. Let's say this increase of mobile is sort of important because there are things you can do on mobile, on real computers or desktops like I'm using here that you can't really do on mobile. It's not so easy to record these lectures on mobile. And it's not so easy to write software on mobiles. But of course, that's not what the world is using computers for. And the fraction of mobile use, since here's the total internet traffic, and here we're going up to 2014, when the expectation is that the mobile use this year is around 30% of the total traffic. So it's coming up there and all soon over. I mean, presumably people expect it to become the dominant use of the internet, just because the number of mobile devices is bound to be larger than the number of desktops. And we all know the PCs are sort of struggling, even laptops are struggling, and even actually tablets are struggling because they'll be competing with phablets, these large smartphones. So it's lots of interesting trends here. Now here we have a plot of the smartphone vendors. We know Samsung is a big dominant vendor with very successful products, so is Apple. Apple, of course, has a nice jump due to the iPhone 6, and Samsung is trying to come back with its pretty healthy line. And then we have here the Chinese vendors, which have drastic increase. And of course, they're dominantly competing in the different markets. They're going to India and China itself. Here we have the Korean and more Korean vendors. And we have here BlackBerry, which is sort of not disappearing. Somewhere in here is Windows, which is actually sort of somewhat healthy, maybe due to enterprise use. And Windows, of course, Microsoft purchased Nokia. So pretty interesting trends. Not quite certain. I don't think anybody knows how it will continue, though. The Chinese vendors have a huge installed local base, which they can use to be very competitive in India and other developing countries. And here we have another variant on the operating system picture. The previous graph was only for smartphones, and here we have the overall world. And we pointed out there was a big period here from maybe 97 to 2007, where we had a dominance by Windows. And since then, we've had this drastic surge because of all the smartphones running Androids or iOS, Apple. And Windows has gone from 96% in this period, sort of important period of the early growth of the commodity computing, down now and only being a third. Of course, at the beginning of the world, there were many other operating environments, all these early machines, and Windows was quite small around the early 80s. So this shows that technology, there's all these disruptive changes, and that leads to big changes. These last two slides are not so important, in my opinion. This tells you that most of the internet users are actually also cloud users. And that's from 2013 to 2018. And the final slide shows that the number of users per cloud storage service, showing that Here's the Apple Google Drive, which is, I must admit, the one I use most. Microsoft is actually bigger than Google Drive, according to this, with Dropbox still the dominant. And Box, which is, for instance, used by Indiana University, is sizable, but nowhere near these other major vendors. And these numbers of users are quite healthy. Dropbox has 300 million users, competitive with Apple and Google and Microsoft are in the same broad category. So this shows we have several viable cloud storage services all living, all with 200 to 300 million users. Pretty interesting. So that's the end of this lesson four of Unit 2. And it was discussing just overall trends that we see in the world, in the technology world. Thank you very much. This is Jeffrey Fox signing off.